Good evening, everyone. It is Friday night. Welcome to Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio. In the studio tonight with me, as always, is my co-host, Marky. Marky, how are you doing tonight?
Good evening. Yep, doing well. Thank you, Lenita. Nice to speak to you again.
Have you had a good week?
It's been crazy, I guess, hasn't it, really? It's what I call that 2 or 3 week period year where everything just seems to go to pot, or at least it's all a little bit abnormal.
Really?
It's been no less crazy out on the street where I am, as it has seemingly been in the world.
Yeah, pretty much everywhere. Terrible things have happened this week. But real quick, I want to bring in our guest this week. Our guest this week is an author. And she is the pioneer of the wise woman tradition. I guess I would call you an herbalist because you are a person that knows about how to use herbs to heal in alternative ways. So if everyone would like to welcome Susan Weed to the show.
Hello, Susan.
Good evening, Susan.
Green blessings. I'm so happy to be with you.
I'm wonderful. I'm so, so happy to have you with us. So you do all kinds of things, correct? You do, you teach herbal medicine, ethnobotany, pharmacognosy. What is that?
Pharmacognosy is the ability to recognize the plants from which your medicine comes.
Okay. Now, I wanted to ask you real quick, how did you get interested in using plants and herbs? Was it something that you knew growing up, or was there something that happened in your life that kind of brought you into this?
It was a combination of things. It was certainly, I grew up with food, but not necessarily with herbal medicine. My mm-hmm. parents were restaurateurs.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So I grew up in big restaurant kitchens,
mm-hmm.
as well as the front of the house. And I carried on an interest in preparing food myself. And it soon became pretty obvious to me that the basic ingredients were the basic ingredients. And what really changed and made you say, oh, this is from Italy, or oh, this is from China, was the spices and the herbs that were used.
That's what makes all the difference, yeah. In any dish, I mean, you can take basic things. You could take pasta, chicken, vegetables or something. But then when you throw, what makes it unique is, yeah, the blends of the herbs and the spices that you put in. It can make the difference between something tasting Mediterranean or something tasting Italian.
Exactly, or something tasting even from Thailand or China or anywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So that really got my interest on the spices and the herbs. And then my personal story took a kind of odd turn because I got pregnant while I was taking birth control pills.
Oh, wow.
But everyone insisted I couldn't be pregnant, so I kept taking birth control pills for the first 5 months of the pregnancy.
Oh, no.
And there were no sonograms. There was no way for us to know
mm-hmm.
what was going on with my baby and whether or not she was okay. And then one morning, when I was about in the 7th month of pregnancy, I opened a newspaper and there were pictures of thalidomide babies.
Oh.
Do you remember thalidomide, the drug given to pregnant women that caused them to have children without arms and without legs?
Oh, my goodness. Now, I didn't remember the name, but I do remember that happening. That is, oh, my goodness.
So this made me decide, really, on the instant, that I would not put anything that came from a pharmaceutical company into my body.
Mm. Yeah, understandable.
And that then made me more curious about those herbs and spices and how they could be used medicinally.
Now, what ones do people use every day that that have the benefits that they may not even be aware of that are helping them?
Many people use garlic on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
And garlic, of course, is a wonderful herb for the cardiovascular system, as well as to help quench inflammation throughout the body.
But now, I mean, it's really popular for people to use powdered garlic. Does that have the same impact as, say, you know, fresh garlic or even minced garlic that's, you know, been treated in that way? What is the best way to do it? And are those other ways as effective? Will they give you the same benefits?
In general, when it comes to actually ingesting any plant,
mm-hmm.
we have to break the cell wall in order to get at anything in the plant. Therefore, okay. neither we nor anything else on this planet eat raw food.
Okay.
There's little or no nutrition in raw food.
Right.
And there's little or no benefit in raw food. Garlic is a very interesting point. Garlic contains a compound which, when exposed to oxygen, turns into a medicinal compound. So if the garlic has been minced and allowed to sit out for 10 minutes, mm-hmm. it has far more medicine than if you just used a fresh clove of garlic. And when the garlic has been dried and powdered, it has lots more medicine than the fresh garlic.
Wow. That's really surprising. I was honestly concerned, you know, whenever I use a powdered, you know, or a dried part of any herb that, you know, it might possibly have less potency than the fresh.
The cell walls of plants are very, very hard. If you look around you, you can probably see something made of wood. Mm-hmm. And wood, of course, is the cell walls of plants. Now, wood is a particularly tough and hard cell wall, but let's think of something even as fragile as grass. You could drive a pickup truck across a lawn, drive it back across the lawn, and the lawn would be none the worse for the wear. The grass would be flattened, but it would stand back up again. Right. Now, you do that over and over again, you are going to wear a track for sure. Mm-hmm. But just once, because the cell wall of that grass is strong enough to withstand being run over by a truck. If I were to lay down and have a truck run over me once, even, not even counting, I would not get up again because I don't have cell walls.
I think those chances would be very slim,
So to get to anything that we need in the plant, we have to break that cell wall. And there are five major ways of doing that. The first is to
You just got really muffled.
Okay.
There you go.
There are five ways to break the cell wall. Apply heat, freeze it, ferment it, dehydrate it, or cover it in oil.
Okay.
I was just reading of a wonderful experiment that they did with monkeys. They presented the monkeys with two machines, and the monkeys could put their food into either machine. One machine did nothing, but after a period of time gave the monkey the food back unchanged. In other words, still raw.
Right.
The other machine cooked the food. The monkeys very quickly figured out which machine was which and thereafter refused to eat any raw food.
Wow. Now, see, so many people will, you know, will say you need to eat raw food, but I think their idea of raw food is a little bit misleading when you think of it in terms of breaking the cell wall.
Exactly. We do have ancestors who did attempt to eat raw food. Their jawbone was twice as big as ours. Their molars, the grinding teeth, were four times bigger than ours. And they had a brow ridge that extended in front of their brow by about 2 inches to anchor a huge chewing muscle. We certainly can't say that the bone record is complete, but we can say that none of the bones that we found of this variety of Homo had been lived in for more than 30 years. Where as soon as we find evidence of cooking, we find bones that are lived in 40, 50, 60 years. So what we generally say is that cooking doubled the human lifespan.
Wow. I think that is so contrary to what a lot of people are hearing coming out of, you know, a lot of different health professionals. They're suggesting don't cook your food because you're killing the vitamins and the minerals. But you're saying that it's actually become better for us.
Well, let's talk about minerals for a moment and then we can talk about vitamins. Suppose that I had a rock with some silver in it.
Mm-hmm.
How would we get the silver out of that rock?
You'd have to heat it.
Wouldn't it destroy the silver?
No.
Because minerals can't be destroyed, can they?
No, that's fast. Yeah, yeah, when you think about it, no, it can't be.
You can't destroy a mineral, and heat, in fact, makes it move from one place to another.
Hmm. Very, very interesting.
So the minerals in your food, just like the silver in that rock, have to be heated in order for your body to utilize them.
Huh. Now, what about vitamins?
All right. I'm going to ask you a question that even really smart people can't answer. So don't feel embarrassed if you can't.
Okay.
You'll make a couple of guesses and that'll be perfect. And okay. They'll be the ordinary guesses. And don't worry about it. That's just fine. Okay. Name a food that contains vitamin A.
Zucchini?
No.
Carrots?
No.
Celery?
No.
Are there any foods that contain vitamin A?
You got it. There's no food that contains vitamin A, because vitamin A is a compound made by the liver.
Oh. You know, when you just said that, I'm going off on a tangent, but this thought just popped in my head, and I want to approach it before it gets lost. There's been some things said recently about vitamin B17 curing cancer, and some people say it's not actually a vitamin. Have you heard about this, and what do you know? What can you tell me about that?
It is a vitamin.
Okay.
The word vitamin was coined because a scientist thought that these substances were vital minerals.
Okay.
That's where vitamin comes from.
Vital minerals. That makes total sense. That's interesting, because that's not something that we're even taught in science class. I've never heard that before. That's fascinating, and that makes perfect sense.
But we soon learned that they weren't vital minerals at all, that in fact, vitamins are complex, cooperative groups of enzymes that function together.
Oh.
In fact, vitamin A is made from carotenes and carotenoids.
Could you say then, if it's made of carotenes, that it is in vegetables in some form, but it's just not fully transformed, or?
Exactly.
Okay.
You have to consume those compounds in a form where your body can use them.
Okay.
So let me tell you two stories about vitamin A,
okay,
or carotenes and carotenoids. There was a scientist who was studying zeaxanthin. It starts with an X, zeaxanthin. And it's found in watermelon and tomatoes. It's really important for good eyesight. And he was bringing volunteers into the lab, and he was feeding them foods with zeaxanthin, and he was measuring their blood before and after. And he was mostly feeding them raw tomatoes and raw watermelon. And he could not find any zeaxanthin in their blood.
Why was that?
He was tossing and turning, and then he had a dream. And in his dream, he was in the North Pole feeding frozen tomatoes and frozen watermelon to people. Remember, there are five ways to break the cell wall. Apply heat.
Cold.
Freeze. Not just cold, but freeze.
Freeze.
Right. Ferment, dehydrate, and cover in oil. So he froze the tomatoes and the watermelon and gave them to people, and there was zeaxanthin in their blood.
Wow.
It's held behind the cell wall, and you can't get to it until you break that cell wall.
That is fascinating. I've noticed my broccoli breaks down whenever we freeze it, and it frustrates me because it becomes kind of mushy when it thaws. If you don't like cook it right away, then you have kind of mushy broccoli, and I don't like that.
However, what that indicates is that the minerals and vitamins are now available to you.
Wow. Okay.
So long as there's a crunch, you're not getting any nutrition.
But I love that crunch. That's so sad.
I'm not trying to interfere with your pleasure.
Yeah.
But what I suggest that people do is eat for nutrition first and pleasure.
Yeah. Well, no, I totally agree. It's just, it's a little sad. Well, that their fresh broccoli isn't quite as healthy for you as you know, one that's been frozen or exactly. Is cooked broccoli? Is
because
cooked
if, broccoli? If you do two of these things, of course, you get more nutrition. So you cook and then freeze. Then
Or freeze and then cook?
Well, you have to blanch your broccoli and cook it a little bit before you freeze it, or it will really not work.
Okay.
All right. And then the other story I wanted to tell you about vitamin A has to do with lycopene. And lycopene, of course, is found in tomatoes, and we know it's a tremendous anti-cancer compound. So we're going to imagine that we are harvesting a beautiful, luscious, ripe tomato and cutting it in half, not top to bottom, but side to side. And we're going to put the cut side down of that raw tomato on a white Formica countertop. And then we're going to take the other half of a tomato and on low heat, let it cook. And we're going to let both tomatoes stay in their respective spots for 24 hours. At the end of 24 hours, we will have a raw tomato cut side down on a white Formica counter and a tiny bit of tomato paste in our pan. We're going to take a spoon, scrape the tomato paste out of the pan, put it on the white Formica counter, turn around, grab a washcloth or a sponge, and wipe the Formica counter. My question to you is a twofold question. Is there a stain on the counter, and what made the stain?
There's definitely going to be a stain on the counter. I'm not sure what makes that stain, though. Dyes are made naturally through plants.
You had two things on the counter, a raw tomato and cooked tomato. Which one stained the counter?
The cooked one.
Correct. That means that the lycopene in the cooked one was available and in the raw one was not.
Oh, wow. That's just, it's really mind-blowing because, I mean, so many things that, you know, are perceived or believed to be healthier are actually not. And I think that, okay, this is why I bring you and others like you on my show, is because this information is so important. It's so vital that people know these things because so many don't.
Exactly. Exactly. Let's continue on because I think this is fascinating and you can stop anytime. I think we've established that to get minerals, we need to break the cell wall and cooking is a great way to do it. I think it's been established that to get vitamin A, we can eat the liver of another thing like cod liver oil contains vitamin A, or we need to cook our vegetables or freeze them or dehydrate them.
Right.
Or ferment them or cover them in oil so that we can get the carotenes and carotenoids. Now, B vitamins, and you were just asking about B17 later. B vitamins are primarily found in muscle tissue, beans, and grains. So are we suggesting that we should eat those things raw in order to get B vitamins?
No, obviously not. Not based on what you've said.
Well, I don't think most people would like to eat raw beans.
No.
Green beans are probably not too bad. You could indeed, but they all beans do contain a substance which interferes with our ability to utilize important nutrients in our body, which is deactivated by cooking.
Oh, wow.
So even green beans are truly not safe to eat raw. And of course, I did have a really crazed macrobiotic brother-in-law who ate his brown rice raw, but I don't think most of them want to.
Now,
the only way that you could destroy those B vitamins at home is by cooking at a temperature higher than boiling.
Okay.
So how would you cook at a temperature higher than boiling?
Higher than boiling? I can't.
That would be
baking?
That would be a pressure cooker.
Pressure cooker. Okay.
So don't use a pressure cooker to cook beans or grains or meats. Because a pressure cooker does destroy the B vitamins. That super hot temperature does break them down. B vitamins are water soluble. So if you cook grain or beans in a huge amount of water and pour the water off, then you will lose B vitamins. But most people don't, do they?
No.
Most people cook their beans or their grains in just enough water so that the bean or the grain is cooked.
Yep.
So there is no wastage of the B vitamins.
Now, if you cook the beans, like, you know, when you go to a an Asian restaurant and they have the beans that are cooked just barely tender, so they're just, but they still have some crisp, but they're barely tender. Is that enough to release the vitamins in them?
No.
No? Okay.
Nor the minerals.
Again, well, that's a shame because I really love them that way.
You can still eat them.
Yeah, I know, but I won't be getting the nutrition from them that I want.
If it doesn't give you nutrition, you can still eat it. It's okay. Yeah. You love it. That's fine. You love it. Eat it. That's okay. Just be sure to drink your nourishing herbal infusions, and we'll talk about those later on.
Yeah, we need to get to those later, definitely.
So, very quickly then, vitamin C. Vitamin C can be destroyed by cooking. What else destroys vitamin C?
Light. I hope not freezing.
No, light. Well, freezing, of course. Light, cold, water, and time. As a matter of fact, vitamin C exists only for about 15 minutes.
Are you kidding?
No.
Wow.
On the other hand, our need for vitamin C is minuscule. A healthy adult needs 60 milligrams of vitamin C a day.
Okay. Don't people overdose on vitamin C, though? When they're sick, they take these vitamin C tablets, and they've got huge amounts of vitamin C in it because they believe it boosts their immune system.
Great many laboratories and seen all of that vitamin C in people's urine.
Uh-huh.
The body does not use it. However, we do have good studies showing that people who take 300 milligrams of vitamin C a day or more double the risk of adult onset diabetes.
Wow. Huh. And I think that would be something that would sway people away from it if they knew that.
One would only hope so.
Yeah. I can't imagine someone wanting to take a daily supplement of that level knowing that it might cause diabetes.
Right. That it will increase your risk. Not that it causes it, but it increases your risk. Right? Increase of risk is not causation.
Right.
So I call vitamin C the bend over vitamin. Bend over, pick a wild leaf, eat it. Reach up, pick a piece of wild fruit, eat it. You've gotten your vitamin C for the day.
Now, does any fruit have vitamin C in it?
All plants contain vitamin C. It's a primary antioxidant created by plants to stabilize their tissues.
Okay. All right.
So, yes, any plant you eat will have plenty of vitamin C.
Now back to the B17. Where is that found essentially? And I've heard that it's been outlawed in the United States.
Vitamin B17 is in all grains. It's in all beans. It's in all nuts. It's in all seeds. It cannot be outlawed.
Aha. So probably what they've outlawed is like isolating it.
Correct. Supplements can be outlawed. Okay. But a vitamin can't be outlawed.
Mm. All right.
It's like saying they've made it against the law to sing.
So if somebody, have you heard, you know, the rumors and the talk about that vitamin helps in preventing cancer? And do you believe there's any truth to that?
I certainly have heard, you know, talk about it for over 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have strong scientific evidence? The best scientific evidence we have shows that people who do not take supplements but eat a broad and varied diet of mostly cooked, frozen, dehydrated, fermented food live the longest.
Fermented food is really important, isn't it?
It certainly is. Now, you know, people who claim that they eat raw food eat fermented food, and they eat dehydrated food, and they spend endless hours massaging their kale with oil.
Mm-hmm.
I had a dear friend, but she's no longer into raw food. But when she was, we decided, being Americans, that we were going to make a little money off our difference of opinion. So we rented a video studio and videographers and a mediator, and we had the raw versus cooked debate.
I think I saw that on YouTube. That's available on YouTube, isn't it?
That is on YouTube because you know, when I saw the video, I said, oh, we can't sell this because I don't think that Brigitte looks good in the video.
Mm-hmm.
It certainly doesn't sound very intelligent in the video. And what happened was somebody bootlegged a copy and put it up at YouTube.
Yeah, and I'm going to see if I can find a link to it because there's listeners in the chat room, and so we can share them links in the chat room so they can check out that debate. Let's see, Raw versus Cooked. Aha. Oh, part 106. It's a long debate, it looks like.
It's an hour.
Is it really? Wow. Yes.
Yeah, we set it up like a real debate. You know, I got X amount of minutes, and then she got X amount of minutes, and then I got rebuttal time, and then she got rebuttal time, and then I got wrap-up time, and she got wrap-up time.
Well, I tell you what, I found a playlist for it, so I'm going to share the link in chat for everyone. There it is, and I'll let you guys know this is the Raw versus Cooked food debate. There we go. And so now everybody in the chat room has the link to that, so they can check that out at their leisure, put it on their watch list, you know, come back later if they want to continue listening to the show. Oh, and for everybody out there listening, if you have some, you know, health questions about herbs or supplements and things like that, and you want to ask Susan about this, you can call in. The number is 310-421-4053. That's via phone. And I'll give you that number again in a second if you didn't have a pen ready. And via Skype, you can call Freedom Screen 2. And that will also bring you in. And if you have any questions for Susan or any comments about what we're talking about, be sure and give us a call in. And the number again is 310-421-4053. Okay, back to our discussion.
Okay, so while you were doing that, I looked up the foods highest in Laetril, B17.
Okay.
And that is blackberries, blueberries, strawberries, lima beans, macadamia nuts, grape seeds, and they also include apricot kernels and peach kernels. But do be aware that both apricot kernels and peach kernels are poisonous.
Oh, so probably a bad idea.
Laetril vitamin B17 in isolation is considered to be a poison by the Food and Drug Administration. And
that's probably why they banned it.
I personally would never take any nutritive substance in a supplement form.
Right.
If I wanted more Laetril, I'd eat more of those foods.
The first part of that list was actually so many things that I love. I've actually got a package of blueberries in my fridge, and I'm going to make some blueberry muffins in the morning. Now, making them in muffins should release them, right? Should release the nutrients in them?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Perfect way to do it.
Awesome. Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. And I love macadamia nuts, too.
Okay, so just two more vitamins to talk about. Vitamin D. And, of course, we're not going to get vitamin D from our food. We're going to make vitamin D from the sunshine. And if you expose
the best way.
From your elbows to your fingertips and your face between 11 and 2 on sunny days between spring equinox and fall equinox, you'll make 20,000 international units of vitamin D daily, which can be stored for up to 2 years.
So instead of drinking milk from a cow, which is highly inadvisable and has been said that it is toxic for us, we've been misled for so long.
Oh,
it's better just to go out in the sun.
More milk is the first food, the last food, and the best food every day in between. And I personally keep a herd of dairy goats. I don't know of any way that people can be healthy without dairy products in their diet.
But milk, cow's milk?
Sure, cow's milk. Absolutely. Any kind of milk is better than no milk. I keep a herd of dairy goats, but when I don't have milk for my goats, you bet I drink cow's milk.
Really?
Of course I do. Milk is a fabulous food. It is the original herbal medicine.
Now, would you drink the stuff that's pasteurized that you get in the store?
Any milk is better than no milk.
Really? Okay.
Any broccoli is better than no broccoli.
Well, that's a given. I've heard lots of people say my preference
is yogurt. I don't drink.
Well, I like dairy products. I like dairy products. I've been hearing a lot lately that that drinking milk is a bad idea. That humans are the only species that continue to drink milk after they've grown.
It's not true. Humans are the only species with a thumb, and therefore we know how to milk other animals. But if one of the apprentices lets the goat step in the milk and we put that pan of milk out, every animal from the forest will come and drink it.
Huh. Well, I know dogs and cats will.
Obviously, all animals adore milk. It's one of the best foods on the planet, and make it even better by fermenting it into yogurt.
Okay, what about cheese?
Cheese even better.
Really?
Cheese and yogurt from my dairy. The latest study found that there was no detriment to the bones eating any amount of cheese. And there was no detriment to the bones eating any amount of yogurt. But that after 3 glasses of milk a day, there is detriment to the bones.
Well, wow.
So those are pretty broad guidelines mm-hmm. to go by. Any amount of cheese, any amount of yogurt.
But now cheese is high in fat. So a lot of people need to keep that out of their diet as much as possible just to avoid weight gain.
The more fat in your diet, the healthier you'll be. Minerals are not absorbable unless you have a high fat diet.
Wow. Well, there are people all over, especially in dairy states like Wisconsin, that will be very, very happy to hear that. That gives them an excuse because I come from Wisconsin. It is the land of cheese. I mean, everything is cheese. Literally, people call us cheddar heads there. They call us cheddar heads. And if you ever watch a football game, a Green Bay Packer game, you will see people with wedges of cheese on their heads. So everyone listening in Wisconsin is going to be thrilled to be vindicated and say, yes, cheese is a good thing. I should be eating it. Yay.
Exactly. People all over the world eat cheese. You know, it's a very interesting thing. When I was in Japan, every household that I had a meal in served me some kind of dairy product, whether it was milk or cheese or mm-hmm. yogurt. And they were very, very proud to be able to do so. And they told me that for far too long a time, Japan shut itself off from the world, and that meant it had to grow all of its own rice. And Japan is actually a very mountainous area, and it's not suited to growing rice. Oh. When they finally gave up on it, all of that mountainous area is just wonderful for dairying. And so now instead of trying to grow rice, they import their rice, and mm-hmm. they have fabulous dairy that they make right there in Japan.
Nice. Now, do they have different types of cheeses there than we wouldn't find here?
There are different types of cheeses all over the world. But, you know, I am a feminist, and so mm-hmm. I always ask myself, does this have anything to do with women when it comes to fluids?
Uh-huh.
Because I find that men can be fluid phobic.
Really?
And so I ask myself, who makes milk? Whether it's a cow or a goat, it's always a mama. Women make milk. And I find that, by and large, it's men who say that milk is awful.
That's interesting. Mark, do you drink milk?
I think they got mama issues, Lenita.
They might.
You know?
They might. Awkward. I love milk.
You love milk? Hey, he's exceptional.
I'm trying to have some now, but I can't quite reach
them. No, lots of men who love their mothers like milk. So let's see. We said there were a couple more vitamins. Vitamin E. Mm-hmm. And vitamin E is found in all whole grains, all beans, all nuts, all seeds. But let's revisit what I said before, and that is that the seeds of all plants contain anti-nutritional compounds. And these compounds are there in the seed to prevent us from eating the raw seeds.
Oh. These
anti-nutritional compounds, including phytic acid, phytates, and a host of others, actually chelate or latch onto things like selenium, calcium, and other nutrients that are vitally needed by the immune system, the nervous system, and the cardiovascular system, and draw down overall reserves of nutrition in the body.
Well, that's like a natural survival instinct, isn't it, for the plants to do that, because that ensures that the seeds don't get eaten so they can be planted and more plants can grow.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. But we clever monkeys have figured out that we can roast our nuts. We can boil our grains, right?
Right.
We can apply heat to these seeds, and we can still get the vitamin E if we cook the grain right then and eat it right then. Mm. Or if we roast the nut and eat it right then. Or if we grind the nut, roast it, and grind it into peanut butter, that we get the vitamin E. And we also find that we get vitamin E in oils.
Yeah.
Like extra virgin olive oil.
Olive oil, yeah.
Excellent source of vitamin E.
And now that also can be used to help break vegetables down to release their minerals too.
What a good listener you are. A big hug and a kiss. Yes.
You give the best hugs.
And people say to me, well, doesn't vinegar break things down? And I say, how many shirts do you have with a vinegar stain as compared to how many shirts do you have with an oil stain?
Yeah, very true.
And we all have a favorite piece of clothing that we can't bear to throw out, even though we know we'll never get that oil stain out of it. And that's because the oil is actually broken down and cooked the fibers of the plant that made up the material of your shirt. So, yes, oil does indeed actually break it down. Yeah. A really excellent study showing this looked at breast cancer incidence and salad consumption.
Wow.
Women who ate salad without salad dressing had as much breast cancer as women who never ate salad.
Wow.
Women who ate salad with no fat salad dressing. And these are women who were just eating salad every day. Mm-hmm. Had as much breast cancer as women who never ate salad. Women who ate salad with low fat salad dressing had as much breast cancer as women who never ate salad. The only women who had less breast cancer were women who added half an avocado or two tablespoons of oil to every serving of salad.
Nice. Oh, I love avocados. I love avocados probably more than I should, but they're so delicious in so many ways.
Fatty and delicious, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then one last vitamin, which is vitamin K. And vitamin K is primarily found in cooked leafy greens. And when it comes to cooked leafy greens, I usually ask a question and offer a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is there anybody out there whose grandmother would go to the garden, harvest leafy greens, and cook them? And how did she do that?
Mine did. I don't recall how she cooked them, but it seems like she either steamed or boiled them.
She boiled them, and she would usually harvest them first thing in the morning, boil them greens down all day.
Okay.
And so my challenge is the one-hour challenge. The next time you have kale or collards or any kind of leafy green to cook, cook it for an hour.
Okay.
And see what your body says about it. Now, I do not send any of my vegetables for swimming lessons. No matter how much kale or collards I am cooking, I do not put a gallon of water in my pot. I usually start with 1 inch of water in the bottom of the pot.
Okay.
And as I cook it, I check to make sure there's enough water at the bottom of the pot.
Now, won't steaming do just as effective, or is it not? Because I just had Swiss chard the other day, and I usually steam it.
For an hour?
No.
There's the problem right there.
Okay.
To steam it, you have to keep the water boiling for an hour. Mm-hmm. That uses a lot more fuel than the way I'm telling you to cook it.
Yeah, because I usually cook it until it's cooked, you know, until it's tender and ready. However, I will say that, totally gone blank on it. Artichokes. We would definitely cook those for an hour because it takes that long for them to cook through when you're steaming them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So by cooking your kale or collards directly in a pot with water, you also don't throw out any B vitamins, because when you steam it, everybody I see throws out the steaming water.
Right.
And that's where your B vitamins are.
Okay. So you want to keep you want to have just enough water in there so that you've got some to have with it.
That's right.
Okay. All right.
And especially if we're going to freeze it. So the challenge is to cook your greens for an hour and see if your body would ever let you go back to previous ways. Now, with something like spinach or Swiss chard, a light green, we would braise it by throwing it into hot oil first until it gets limp, and then put like a handful of water, a little bit of tamari, and clamp a hot lid on, a tight lid on it, put it on the back burner, very low fire for its hour cook.
Okay. That makes sense. Yeah. I don't think I've ever cooked them in oil before. Like just a small amount or?
Small. Well, the oil, of course, breaks the cell wall in those lighter greens. Right. Right.
Okay.
And then you cook it at that low heat for the hour, and then you start to get minerals from it.
Okay. Awesome.
Awesome. So yes. I think we've made the case for not eating foods raw.
Yeah. And
let's talk about another way of getting additive nutrition, because we've been seeing all along that, like, if you throw it in oil and then cook it for an extended period, mm-hmm. you get more because you've used two of these techniques. So we're going to take a plant like stinging nettle, which is a very nourishing plant, and mm-hmm. we're going to dehydrate it. And it's going to decrease in weight by 3/4. So 4 ounces, 1/4 pound of fresh mm-hmm. nettle will dry down to 1 ounce of dried nettle.
Now, where do you find that? Because I don't see stinging nettle anywhere. Are you going to have to, like, look online? Or, I mean, do you suggest just planting it? Where's the best way to locate stinging nettle? Because I've never seen it in the produce section ever.
No one would sell fresh stinging nettle.
It
would be kind of crazy. I have seen it at farmers markets, but generally you wouldn't. And again, you wouldn't want to buy it fresh. You want to buy it dried. And there are any number of wonderful herbal retailers and wholesalers throughout the United States. If you go to my website, susanweed.com, mm-hmm. there are click-through buttons for several herbal sellers, uh-huh. Mount Rose Herbs, Frontier Herbs, lots of people out there doing a really good job of selling herbs. So we want to take that fresh nettle, and fresh nettle, stinging nettle does grow all over the continental United States. Look at rich, damp soils if you're looking for it. We're going to dry that 4 ounces of fresh nettle down mm-hmm. to 1 ounce of dried nettle, or we're going to go buy an ounce of dried nettle. It'll cost about $1. We're going to take that 1 ounce of dried nettle, put it into a quart jar, fill the jar with boiling water, put a tight lid on it, and let it steep for a minimum of 4 hours, but not longer than 10 hours.
Okay.
That will then provide us with all of the nutrition of that 1/4 pound of fresh nettle.
Nice.
And we get it all because we first dehydrated it and then put boiling water over it.
Okay. So now, the nettle, what kind of benefits are we getting from the nettle?
Stinging nettle contains every mineral known to be needed in human nutrition.
Wow.
Stinging nettle contains lavish amounts of every vitamin, including vitamin E, known to be needed. It is one of the world's richest sources of vitamin K.
Uh-huh.
It has huge amounts of carotenes and carotenoids. It's extremely high in calcium, magnesium, chromium, cobalt, iron, phosphorus, potassium, zinc, the B complex of vitamins, and it's very low in sodium. It's high in protein, and it contains polyphenols, which you've probably heard about.
And, no.
And catechins. Polyphenols and catechins is what makes green tea such a hot thing.
Oh, really? Okay. That would be okay.
And you find those things in stinging nettle as well. Stinging nettle is the energy of the earth. When you drink stinging nettle, you wake up in the morning raring to go. You work as long as you need to work. You lay down and go to sleep.
Wow. Now, that's a question. My daughter was having trouble sleeping. And we went, oh my goodness, yesterday we had such trouble trying to get her seen somewhere. So they put her on an anti-anxiety medicine. But would a herbal infusion of stinging nettle help her get more regular in a sleep pattern, do you think?
Perhaps, but let's talk.
Okay.
Let's broaden our discussion just for a little bit. So you found someone who went to the pharmacy and fulfilled a prescription for your daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yeah.
You didn't do it. Your daughter didn't fulfill that prescription. Somebody else did that.
Right.
Who was that other person who fulfilled that prescription?
The doctor.
The doctor left the doctor's office and went to the pharmacy and got the prescription and brought it to you.
Oh, no, we got that. No, I thought you meant prescribed it.
But did the doctor go to the pharmacy or did
No, we went.
Oh, so the doctor didn't put you on anything or put your daughter on anything, did he? He gave you a prescription, but you chose, and your daughter chose to take it, yes?
Yes, so she didn't want to. That's part of why she wanted me to talk
to you
today.
Wait a second. If she didn't want to, then she should not have.
Yeah.
Because we must be responsible for what we choose. If we go to the pharmacy and we buy something and we open it and we take one out and we put it in our mouth and swallow it, we have chosen, and it's no good to say I didn't want to.
That's exactly what happened, actually. She didn't take it. She's been waiting
so
that I could talk to you.
That she didn't take it, right? So the doctor didn't put her on anything.
He suggested.
The doctor made a suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to decide whether or not we are going to follow that suggestion.
I agree.
So, first of all, how old is your daughter?
She's 19. That's part of why we had so much trouble getting her to see a doctor, by the way. her healthcare coverage went out, and she tried to do the whole Obamacare thing and ran into all sorts of problems. And we just went through a whole nightmare of just even trying to be seen.
And how long has she had difficulty going to sleep?
Oh, she's had that for quite a while, actually. It's been an ongoing thing, and that's why she just...
Are we talking about months or years?
Years. Years. Yeah.
Since she was 10?
Probably. I'm thinking probably about 4 years.
So since she was 15?
About there, yeah.
Was there any incident that happened to her in her life around that time?
No, not that I can think of.
So... she didn't have a boyfriend and then not have a boyfriend or have somebody.
She had a friend. It wasn't a boyfriend. It was actually just a normal friend that just kind of, I don't know how else to say it, but just kind of just dropped out of her life because, you know, she wasn't cool enough anymore or something to that extent. So
during those years, we can take that kind of thing very deeply to heart.
Mm-hmm.
During our teenage years, we're kind of asking ourselves a question that we don't ask again until we get pretty old, and that is, do I deserve to exist?
Yeah.
Once we get past that puberty, do I deserve to exist, we just kind of take it for granted until we get up in years, and then again we go, do I deserve to exist? And when somebody drops us like that, or when somebody dies, we can take it as, I don't deserve to exist. And we kind of become wakeful because we're almost afraid that if we go to sleep, we'll die. And obviously, the doctor that you saw thinks something similar, which is why, rather than a sleeping potion was prescribed, an anxiety potion was prescribed.
Mm-hmm.
So I work with the seven medicines.
Okay.
Serenity medicine, story medicine, mind medicine, lifestyle medicine, alternative medicine, pharmaceutical medicine, and high-tech medicine. You and your daughter, like many people, chose to enter the seven medicines at one of the most dangerous medicines, which is pharmaceutical medicine. In fact, the first four medicines, serenity medicine, story medicine, mind medicine, and lifestyle medicine, always build health.
Yeah, that's kind of why she was wanting a little bit of advice, is because she's tried meditation, but she's gotten in a point where she just can't quiet her mind for some reason. She just can't make her mind shut up, and she's tried different forms of meditation, and so she was hoping maybe there was something herbal that could help her calm the mind a little bit more.
Serenity medicine is not necessarily about calming the mind.
Okay.
Serenity medicine is not necessarily about meditation. Especially when it comes to sleeping, serenity medicine means no blue light from a computer screen or a phone screen within an hour of being ready for bed.
Yeah, we actually talked about that yesterday. We talked about not having any electronic devices in her room, making sure that her phone, if she has it in the room, is completely shut off, not just not using it, but shut off completely.
Right.
So yeah, we went through a lot of those things.
Hour before bed, not looking at that. Those lights are blue lights and they gear the brain to wakefulness.
Okay. So she actually needs to stop using all of that for an hour before she wants to get to sleep.
That's a minimum.
Okay.
For some people who are sensitive, it needs to be 2 or 3 hours.
Okay.
So Serenity Medicine is also about being okay if you don't sleep.
Okay.
So I'll tell you a funny story. I went to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, my mentor, once, and I whined at her, and I really did whine. And I said, "You're not letting us have enough sleep. You're working us too hard. You know, we stay up till all hours of the night, and then we get up in the morning, and we start all over again with all these people who are terminal and are upset, and we're not going to get enough sleep." And Elizabeth looked at me, and she said, "You don't need to sleep." And I gaped at her. I said, "Elizabeth, sleep. It's like, you know, food, water, shelter, sleep. It's like major human needs." She said, "No," she said, "what you need is rest, and you don't know how to rest."
Huh.
And she, through mentoring me, challenged me to find those many, many places during the day where I can totally let go and rest, even just for a few seconds. You're waiting in line at the supermarket. Are you tapping your foot? Are you totally letting go and resting?
No.
It's a red light. Are you gripping the steering wheel like you're going to squeeze gold out of it? Are you totally letting go and resting? Your computer is downloading something. Are you tapping your foot? Thinking of 14 other things you should be doing? Are you totally letting go and resting?
Nope.
If we take all of those little moments to totally let go and rest, then we need very little sleep.
That's very interesting. We are getting ready to go to break. Real quick, before we go to break, I'd like to address, in the chat room, we have a listener, Kun, who is following our conversation, and they said, "Okay, take her to the gym, pump iron, that solves nearly every mental disorder." She actually does love to work out, and she likes to lift weights. So that's actually something, and actually she just got done doing a lot of swimming. She likes to really work out. It kind of helps her relax down after she's exerted herself physically a great deal. It makes it a little bit easier to just kind of collapse and just go and rest when you're done. So yes, she does do that, and I don't think she's done that as much lately as she did a while back, and that actually might help. That might help her a little bit. So yeah, I appreciate that advice, Kun. And so we are getting we're getting ready to go to break. So before we go to break, why don't we real quick, before the music starts, for it's a 5-minute break, we'll get a sponsor break. Go ahead and give information for your books and your website, so when we come back, we can go back into normal topic.
Sure. You can visit me at SusanWeed.com. And I do keep the sun in Susan. But if you spell it Susan, that's okay, because I own SusanWeed.com and SusanWeed.com. Come and visit me. It's a huge website, over 6,000 pages of free information. Yes, there's an internal search engine, so you can find just what you want. If you're interested in my books or my correspondence courses or anything else I offer, please visit me at wisewomanbookshop.com. That's wisewomanbookshop.com. And there you'll find my first book, The Wise Woman Herbal for the Childbearing Year, continuously in print now for 30 years. Used all over the world by pregnant women and midwives. And then my second book, The Second Wise Woman Herbal, Healing Wise, the big green book for everybody, the one that turned herbalism on its ear by suggesting that the plants could talk to us. New menopausal years, The Wise Woman Way, has sold several million copies and translated into half a dozen different languages. It's a women's menopause Bible.
And we will be back after the break.
Welcome back. You're listening to Anomalous Realities with host Lanita Elder, special guest Susan Weed, and some British guy.
Nice, nice. Thank you, Marky. Okay. So now, everyone, I want to just take a minute to remind everyone that Revolution Radio is 100% listener supported. If you appreciate what we're doing, if you appreciate the messages that we're bringing to you, if you like what you're hearing, take a minute on the website, hit the support us button. Anything that you can do will help out. You can make a one-time donation or a monthly subscription. Actually, I think it's just under $5 a month to subscribe to the archives, which also helps the station as well. Because you guys are what makes this happen. Without you, you would hear silence when you tune in. So give if you can. And now we'll go back to our guest. We are talking tonight with Susan Weed, who is an author and a feminist, a proponent of healthy living through herbs. And if you would like to call in and ask a question of Susan tonight, you can call in on the number 310-421-4053. Or you can also call Skype at Freedom Screen 2. And now we'll go back to Susan. Hello, hello. Are you back with us?
Green blessings. I'm right here.
Yes. Okay. So now I think we kind of wrapped up what we were talking about pretty well before the break, if I'm not mistaken. Did we have anything we were still kind of left hanging?
Yes, we were talking about your daughter's sleepless.
Yes, yes.
And we were talking about the seven medicines.
Okay, yes.
Said that the first four medicines always promote health, but the last three medicines undercut health.
Okay.
And so we were talking about serenity medicine,
mm-hmm.
and that serenity medicine also has to do with being serene about the fact that you're not sleeping.
Okay.
It's not being serene so you can sleep. It's about being serene because you're not sleeping. Michelangelo was said never to have slept more than 4 hours at a time.
This is true. I think all of the great minds actually were said to have only slept in small shifts. I think Nikola Tesla was the same way.
And Thomas Edison and mm-hmm. on and on and on.
Yeah.
So again, where do we have it that in order to be okay, I have to sleep for 8 hours at one stretch?
That's what we're told. It's what we're told.
And if your daughter is trying to force herself into that mold, then serenity medicine suggests that she stop and okay. she say, hey, maybe I'm a four-hour sleeper. Maybe yes. I follow the normal human pattern, which is 8 hours awake, 4 hours asleep, 8 hours awake, 4 hours asleep.
Yeah.
And that is far more normal across far, far more human cultures than the way that we do it.
Mm-hmm.
With it's saying that we're supposed to sleep 8 hours and be awake for 16.
Well, you know, they do that because of the societal setup and the way they want people to be workhorse slaves in our society. And in order to produce the way they want us to produce, we kind of have to assimilate to that schedule. If you don't, you know, then you can't do what they need you to do. So, yeah, it's definitely something that's...
Don't you wind up being a homesteader and homeschooling, huh?
Exactly, yeah.
Which lots of us are, because we have those options, because we say, you know what, that pattern, it doesn't work for me. And I see this very clearly in my granddaughter. She actually enjoyed school, but she did not want to get up at that hour.
Mm-hmm.
And since she didn't have to, she opted not to.
Right.
So again, what I'm saying is that for your daughter, serenity medicine is to say, it's okay.
You don't have to conform to the norm.
You don't have to conform. And I find that many people, rather than saying, hey, I'm awake, what shall I do? Say, I better go to sleep. I have to go to sleep. I'm going to be a real grump tomorrow.
Right.
Hey, we know how that kind of self-talk winds up. It winds mm-hmm. up absolutely true.
Wow.
So let's not.
Yeah.
Let's not. Let's just say, whatever sleep I get, and it is deep and restful, and I am grateful for it. And that's serenity medicine.
Yeah.
Then when we go to story medicine, well, I'm really changing the story here for you. Rather than saying, hey, you have to go to sleep. This is critically important. You need this much sleep. I'm giving you a different story.
Okay.
You went to a doctor for a story, and that story is called a diagnosis.
Mm.
And unfortunately, that diagnosis usually comes with a prescription attached to it,
mm-hmm.
which we then for reasons we have not examined, believe that we must follow the prescription or the advice. We do not. Asking someone to tell us a story about what's going on with this can be only asking for a story. If you went to an acupuncturist, you would get a different story. If you went to a chiropractor, you would get a different story.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important to have a story that resonates with you. It's important to have a story that predicates a healing path that you are comfortable on. She's not comfortable on the healing path of going to see a doctor. She doesn't have insurance. Sounds perfect to me. Good. Maybe she won't go to see any more doctors.
Yeah, she avoids medications as much as possible. She hates taking anything for pain. She would rather deal with it in any way other than, you know, some sort of over-the-counter, you know, pill or something. She just avoids medicines, which I think is wonderful. That's why she wanted me to seek your help in this, because she knew that there had to be something natural she could do.
Right. So story medicine, what story, you know, she's chosen a story by going to a doctor here that doesn't work for her. We can discard that one. What other story works for her? And then mind medicine or energy medicine. And I often say this is as vast as the shaman's playground. And this could include flower essences, gemstone elixirs, visualizations, prayer, Reiki, homeopathy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whatever works in terms of engaging our ability to think ourselves well. Not only thinking ourselves well only works half the time, but you know what? I'm enough of a pragmatist to say, if it works half the time, let's figure out which half it works for and have everybody do it. And the half it works for, they're well, and the other half will go on with.
Yeah. I honestly agree with that. If you can put yourself in the mindset that there's nothing wrong, you can actually heal things. I think a lot of sicknesses that people have come from negative thoughts and negative energy and putting yourself in a negative place and allowing that to draw your energy down to where you become sick, physically sick.
Well, I have to tell you that I love negativity.
Why is that?
If you were to take a screwdriver and take the plate off of the light switch on the wall of your house and disconnect the negative wire, your house would be dark.
Right.
Negative energy is what the energy comes into your house on. Negative energy is what drives life. Negative energy, without negative energy in music, it's just all run together. Without negative space in art, it's just a mishmash of colors. It is the negative energy that really creates the aura around the other. So I love negative energy because I love the deep and nourishing dark, and I love to be down. I don't want to be high. I want to be down. I want to be earthy. I don't want to be out of my body. I want to be embodied. I want to be of the earth. I want my heart to beat with the heartbeat of the earth.
I don't know that negativity necessarily connects you to the earth.
Oh, but it does, because the earth is dirty and dark, and therefore it is negative. It is yin to the sunny, bright yang.
Well, you have to have both, yeah. I mean,
that's
you need
what I'm
both.
Saying.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. And earth is negative, yin, and dark. That
but when
is
the, when an imbalance
is.
Comes into play is when it can...
Well, actually, balance is the step that immediately precedes death. What we want is dynamic disequilibrium. We never want balance, because balance means that we can't be alive. E.O. Wilson, perhaps one of the most brilliant humans who's ever lived, has said that life exists on this planet because the axis is tilted.
It's interesting.
Any planet that is balanced is barren. No, we need an alternation between negative and positive. And balance is not saying I want only the positive and not the negative. Dynamic disequilibrium says, I love the negative just as I love the positive.
That's very interesting.
That's what wholeness is. Wholeness is about accepting all of ourselves.
Well, you have to be able to accept both. Accepting,
is about accepting the parts of ourselves that are negative, the parts of ourselves that don't sleep.
Right.
And so mind medicine is not about fixing ourselves. It's about finding how our problem expresses our wholeness.
Okay.
Rather than seeing the problem as an enemy to be fought, we see our problem as an ally that can give us greater goods. There's something in every problem that we have that is an enrichment, so long as we can accept the negativity.
What if there becomes an imbalance, though? I mean, well, there has to be... There's never a perfect balance. I mean, I think that's the thing that you try to achieve over the course of life, is to try to balance out between
what I'm
your
saying,
positive and your negative, your light and your dark. But that's never going to fully happen.
Dynamic disequilibrium, and the more dynamic it is and the more disequilibrium you have, the more flexibility you have and the healthier you are.
Okay.
So we want it to be bright during the day and dark at night.
Mm-hmm.
But we want that to change every day. We're coming up to solstice. It's going to be the longest day. And then the very next day, the light will start to recede.
Yes.
And that's as it should be. It is only balanced twice a year at spring equinox and fall equinox. And every other day, it's in dynamic disequilibrium.
Right. It is.
And that's what life is about. It's about dynamic disequilibrium, about being able to give ourselves permission to be everything and not expect ourselves only to be smiling, nice, happy, cheerful, da 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 da. No.
No, nobody can live like that. Nobody can
the
do world, there has
the
to be.
What I did with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross was all about anger and grief. All we did was spend our time with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people who are in the midst of incredible anger and grief. Now, many people would say, whoa, that's really negative. But it's not. It's enriching. It is wholing. And they themselves became more whole the more they were able to reach into and accept their rage and their grief. Not get over it. Not get rid of it. But get into it. I love negativity.
Doesn't that make people sick, though? I mean, well, think about the negativity in terms of stress. Stress can cause so many health issues.
Stress. You need stress. Without stress, there are no bridges. Without stress, there's no tall buildings. Stress is the stuff that keeps you alive.
But doesn't it also make you sick?
No, your maladaption to it makes you sick. Your inability to relax makes you sick.
So how would someone adjust themselves to stress to not allow it to make them sick?
Drink nourishing herbal infusions.
Okay. So now is the singing nettle the only type of herbal infusion, or is there other types?
I rotate through 5 primary herbs: singing nettle one day, red clover another day, linden flowers another day, oat straw another day, and comfrey leaf the 5th day, so that I'm getting 6 quarts of each herb per month.
Okay.
By rotating through those 5. There are other herbs that could be used for nourishing herbal infusion, but in general, we don't use any herb that has a smell.
Mm-hmm.
So no mint or sage or rosemary or lemon balm, we would not use those. No chamomile, but we could use chickweed or mullein.
Okay. What about dandelion?
You could use dandelion. You could use burdock. You could use astragalus.
I've heard things about burdock that it's actually very beneficial.
These all are. And again, okay. We drink about a quart of nourishing herbal infusion a day. And unless we're living in a particularly arid environment, that is the only fluid that we consume that day.
Okay. Now, how much would you consume a day?
A quart a day.
A quart a day
is the right amount of fluid for most adults.
Is it? It always seems like they say you should have so much more than that.
They. Let's find out who they is.
Yeah.
They is an advertising executive for Coca-Cola. He found an obscure army study that said that a soldier needs 2 quarts of fluid per day. The study went on to say 1 quart of that will come from food, and the other quart will come from any beverage that is consumed, including coffee, tea, or anything else. Right. This advertising executive put it out as though you need to drink 2 quarts of water a day, and that only water counts, that tea, as a matter of fact, is a negative, or coffee is a negative. Nothing could be further from the truth. Well, perhaps saying that margarine is better than butter could be good. And that's another one that everybody says, isn't it?
Well, yeah, because the caffeine dehydrates you is what we're told.
It does not.
Really?
Really.
That's interesting. But I notice my husband gets leg cramps whenever he drinks, you know, like something with caffeine in it for a good amount of the day and doesn't get enough water.
But it's not because of dehydration. It's because the caffeine utilizes minerals, and he's probably not replacing enough minerals.
Oh, okay. So he's not actually dehydrated. It's that. Okay. All right. So it's still probably not a good idea if you don't want leg cramps to have too much caffeine, unless you're replacing it in another way.
Caffeine as a substance, like any isolated substance, it can be lethal.
Right.
Caffeine, however, as found in coffee or tea, turns out to have a great many health benefits, and those health benefits seem to accumulate up to about 5 cups of coffee a day.
Mm-hmm.
I don't drink any coffee at all myself, and that
increases
my risk of Parkinson's disease. Your husband is going to have, 47% lower risk of Parkinson's disease because of his coffee drinking.
Huh. That's interesting.
There's solid medicinal benefits to drinking coffee, and a lot of it.
Hmm.
Sweet.
Yeah.
You like coffee?
However, what I say to people is, be sure that you're also drinking nourishing herbal infusion so that you get all the minerals and the nutrients that you need.
Now here, Mark, I thought Brits only drank tea.
Yeah,
one of those stereotypes. See what a bad thing it is to follow a stereotype?
Well, no, I mean, there are people who, you know, there's always a news article where, you know, little old ladies live through to 99 and she swears it on her life it was down to the cups of tea. So still very much a thing.
Well, tea is really good for you too, right?
Exactly. Those catechins and polyphenols we were talking about before.
Yeah.
All right. Very, very important antioxidant and anti-inflammatory substances. Mm-hmm. And it turns out that coffee has them too, along with the caffeine, and that it is an antioxidant. And it has many of the same benefits of tea. So of the nourishing herbal infusions that I drink, we said that stinging nettle is the herb of energy. And we know about people who are feeling their oats and people who are sowing their oats, don't we?
Yeah.
So oat straw, oat straw is the largest selling sexual tonic in Europe for men.
Really?
This comment I loved from a woman in Southern California. She said to me, you know, I got to menopause and my libido went on vacation. Then down there, got as dry as a desert. She said, think sand dunes and palm trees.
Oh.
She said, it got so bad. I got a copy of your book, Susan, New Menopausal Years, The Wise Woman Way. I started reading about oat straw and I said, that's for me. She started making oat straw infusion, weighed out 1 ounce of the dried herb, put it in a quart jar, filled it at the top with boiling water, tightly lid it, allowed to steep 4 to 10 hours, strained it and drank it. She said, not only did her libido come home, her libido came home with company and down there turned into an oasis with palms and dancing girls.
Wow.
So oat straw for women of a certain age, oat straw for men of every age, oat straw for a healthy heart, oat straw for a healthy nervous system. Oat straw is going to be a wonderful ally for your daughter because it will help nervous system to beat more regularly.
Okay, nice.
We can't hear the heartbeat of the nervous system the way we can the heart.
Right.
But we know that what we want to hear if we're listening to the heart is thump, 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 thump. We do not want to hear a jazz bass riff. Thump, 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 right?
Right.
And when our nervous system is doing a jazz riff, we feel rah. We want our nervous system, like our cardiovascular system, to have a rhythm that is regular, and oat straw restores that regular rhythm to the nervous system.
Nice. Very nice. Now, what type of plant, I mean, is oat straw? Is it like a large stalk type plant or what?
It's the, a grass.
It's a grass.
It's the grass of the plant that gives us oats.
Really? Okay.
Oats nice. Is the seed. Oat straw is the grass.
Nice. Okay, so that's pretty common.
Extremely common.
Nice.
And again, it's an item of commerce.
Mm-hmm.
Linden flower, and you use only half an ounce of linden flower per quart of boiling water,
mm-hmm.
is considered one of the world's great anti-inflammatories, safe enough to be used with premature infants.
Oh, my goodness.
And it is also considered to be calming and sleep-inducing.
Wonderful.
So none of these are going to knock her out.
Right.
More long-term remedies to help her be more in her body, mm-hmm. while she's working with the other things. That person who wrote in before the break, the lifestyle medicine, go work out, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like the thing I say, that you're depressed, come and spend a day with the baby goats and tell me about depression. So we know that there are lifestyle things. We know that eating well helps us to sleep. We know that exercising well helps us to sleep. But let's get even a little more specific about that.
Okay.
For many people, drinking caffeinated beverages within hours before sleeping can interfere with their sleep.
Mm-hmm.
And again, that can be 1 hour, 2 hours, 4 hours. For many more people, drinking an alcoholic beverage interferes with sleep.
What about wine? I've heard that wine actually will help.
All alcohol interferes with sleep.
Really?
It does indeed. It makes you feel sleepy, but then your brain is blocked from the deepest levels of sleep.
Now, I don't drink alcohol purposely, because I have this weird thing where whenever I drink more than like one drink of alcohol, I get extreme pain in my veins. It feels like someone's like sticking needles up my arms or my legs. It's the weirdest thing. So it's kind of like a built-in defense system that my body has built against alcohol. I don't know. I've been told you can't be allergic to alcohol, but it certainly seems like I am.
Many women, myself included, have a very low tolerance for alcohol. In general, a woman's liver is smaller than a man's liver, mm-hmm. and that makes us less tolerant. And some of us also, whether it's from genetic things,
right.
seem to have less ability to process the poisons that alcohol creates.
Could be.
And we feel those poisons very, very quickly. That's what I say. I say, give me a glass of wine. I will feel like I've been run over by a car then. And the next day, I will feel like I've been run over by a train. I see you get pleasure from it, but believe me, there is no pleasure at all in it for me.
Personally, I never really did. And I think that's why it was so easy for me to not. Usually when I did attempt was more of a social thing.
It is always a social thing, mm-hmm. unless we are, private alcoholics. And I do know people who are like that, too.
Yeah, there are some.
So we have gone over now the first four medicines, serenity medicine, story medicine, mind medicine, and lifestyle medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And we are about to jump the great divide into the last three medicines, which will always erode health. And here we have alternative medicine, which would include herbal medicine. And mm-hmm. it would include things as light as chamomile tea.
Okay.
Back up in lifestyle medicine, we would have hot milk. Hot milk, especially hot milk with chocolate in it, is quite soporific on the level of chamomile tea.
Okay.
A little bit stronger than chamomile tea would be a few drops of skullcap tincture. A little bit stronger than skullcap tincture would be valerian root tincture.
Now, why are these bad?
I did not say anything was bad.
Okay.
You are creating good and bad. That's your story. It is not mine. I love the negative. I said they erode health.
Isn't eroding health a bad thing?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
If someone is bleeding to death, I would rather erode their health by stopping the bleeding than to give them nettle infusion, which will make them healthy.
Okay.
Because if I give them nettle infusion, they could die. And I will now have a healthy dead person or a slightly injured live person.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
And what we want to do is to always go back. So if we've started out by taking drugs for sleeplessness, we're going to go back to herbs. If we've started out by taking herbs, we're going to go back to the hot milk and the lifestyle things. If we've, you know, we can always go back because serenity is the goal.
Right.
Right? So a little stronger than valerian root would be California poppy.
Oh, my goodness.
Which contains, yes, some alkaloids, some opium alkaloids. Mm-hmm. Juliette de Berkeley Levy would boil one or two green poppy heads to soothe babies.
Wow.
And make them go to sleep. And then, of course, you come right to the edge of soporific things with opium.
Mm-hmm.
And from opium, we can see that pharmaceutical medicine is not far off.
Yeah.
I have not, of course, gone through all herbs that are soporific. Hops is soporific. I've seen people fall asleep next to a cup of hops tea.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm giving you a, you know, kind of a spectrum and a choice.
Yeah.
To say, you know, I'm not talking to her, so I don't know exactly what's going on. But I can give you this example. One of my dearest friends was married to a man who is a very high government official in Canada. In fact, he was the man who started the group that's the equivalent of the Canadian FBI.
Wow.
For this, he was not much loved. As a matter of fact, when I stayed at her house, the room I stayed in was covered in framed political cartoons, floor to ceiling, wall to wall, of nasty cartoons about her husband.
Wow.
No matter how much you believe in yourself, no matter how good your self-respect and your self-worth is, no matter how thick your skin is, that gets to you.
Mm-hmm.
And it interfered with his sleeping. And his doctor gave him a sleeping pill. And he took the sleeping pill and went to sleep. But within a matter of months, he was waking up in the middle of the night and having to take a second sleeping pill.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
And my best friend, his wife, said to me, I don't want to sleep with him. He's zombie man. This is wrecking our marriage. Help, what can I do? And we talked about many of the things we've talked about with your doctor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, about your daughter. And we talked specifically about his not drinking past a certain hour because he was a pretty heavy drinker.
Right.
We talked about his having hot milk or hot chocolate before he went to bed. And I asked him to do this. I asked him to remove all light from his room, cover up the TV if there's a telltale on that. As you say, The electronics totally off, unplugged on a bar, turned off, so that there was no light in the room but a candle. And if he was worried about falling asleep with a candle, and I always have to laugh because people are asking me about sleep problems. The first thing they say when I say burn a candle is, what if I fall asleep?
That's the idea.
So put it in a burn-proof, you know, ceramic holder, put it on top of, you know, a little sheet of tin foil, something so that you don't worry about the candle burning. Light your candle and listen to music or read something that you're interested in for 10 to 15 minutes. Take the tincture you're going to take. For him, it was skullcap tincture.
Mm-hmm.
Blow out the candle, close your eyes, and go to sleep. If you are not asleep within 15 minutes, light the candle. Read some more of your book. Listen to some more of your music. Write another poem. After 15 minutes, take some more of your tincture. For him, it was skullcap.
Mm-hmm.
Blow out your candle. Go to sleep.
Now, she loves candlelight. She loves candlelight. So that's definitely, at least she's kind of going in the right direction there.
Yeah. And it's rare that you would have to repeat this more than 3 times.
Okay.
So have your tincture and some water by the bedside because you want to take your tincture with a little water.
Mm-hmm.
There certainly are situations in which people have gone through such devastating problems that we do want to give them a sleeping pill. That we want something stronger than herbs. There are even situations in which someone has gone through something so horrible that we actually want to put them in an induced coma.
Oh my goodness.
We had a woman at a ritual, and she was given this beautiful printed outfit, but the printing ink had a volatile component. And when she got near the fire, and we're not talking about within the fire in any way, we're talking about a couple of feet from the fire, the right. Volatiles pulled the fire to her, and she was burned over 80% of her body.
Oh, no.
She was put into a healing coma.
Yeah.
So that skin grafts could be done.
Right.
I'm taking this to the extreme so that we can understand that all of these places, all of these medicines are valid medicines. The fact that putting her into coma erodes her health is not significant, is it?
No, not when you consider the other alternatives and what it does for her.
We know that putting her in a coma ain't good for her, but it's better than leaving her in screaming.
Mm-hmm. Pain.
Yeah. It's better than the amount of morphine we would have to pump into her to get her through that pain.
Yeah.
So, yes, we're going to injure her health. In the same way, if somebody's heart stops beating and you do CPR, you are probably going to break their bones.
Yeah.
But you don't say, oh, I don't want to break their breastbone. I don't want to break their rib. I'll just let them die.
Right. No.
No. You injure them. I've been present at births where we had to break the baby's collarbone to get it out.
Wow.
You do it.
You do what you have to do.
Do whatever it takes at that time, and then you do your best to deal with what you did.
Yeah.
Your daughter is nowhere near these circumstances of these.
No.
Right. But as she knows, Serenity Medicine, Story Medicine, Mind Medicine, and Lifestyle Medicine will probably be enough. But if she wants to work with any of those herbs for a short time to help her get over the hump of thinking of herself as sleepless, there's certainly no long-term damage that will be done.
Right. Okay.
Stimulants and sedatives always take us out of our normal range of activity. By doing so, they push us toward dependency.
Yeah, that's something that actually was one of the biggest reservations that she had, because she knew that most of the medications that would be suggested have a tendency to make people dependent upon them, and that is the last thing she wanted, was to have something that she would become dependent on. It's really important to her. She's very independent, and she didn't want anything to, you know, affect her to the way that she felt like she couldn't, you know, deal without it, and that's why she wanted to look for alternative solutions. So, yeah.
Well, I know that that you will find something in our extended conversation about this that can be of use to her.
Okay, good. Excellent. All right, so we've gone through 5 of the 7?
Well, we just talked about inducing coma, which is,
which
is to me, high-tech medicine.
Oh, is it? Okay. That's high-tech. Okay.
It's very high-tech
medicine.
Yeah,
it is.
Inducing a coma.
What else would fall under that care?
We talked about using drugs, and that's pharmaceutical medicine.
That's pharmaceutical,
so we have, in fact, covered all of them.
Now, I want to talk to you about a subject that I know you're very passionate about, and that is essential oils. I want you to speak to our listeners about essential oils, because I know how many people think that they're so wonderful, and I really want you to express to them I think you know what I'm saying.
I absolutely do. So let me start here. I was teaching at an American Herbalist Guild conference. And this particular half hour, I wasn't teaching. and other people were, and I had my books for sale there in the exhibit hall. And I decided, hey, I've got a break. Nobody's here buying anything. Why don't I walk around and look at the other exhibitors? And I noticed as I was walking around that there was a table that had essential oils on it. And so I took several steps off to the side so as to avoid this table. And the woman behind the table saw me and said, come on over. We have wonderful essential oils. And I said, no, no, I do not use essential oils. And up from the table, which had a big tablecloth over it, came a wonderful, wonderful herbalist, a man that I very much admire. His name is Peter Holmes, H-O-L-M-E-S. And he said, what do you mean you don't use essential oils? You can't be an herbalist unless you use essential oils. I put essential oils in all of my remedies. I'm teaching class. In 20 minutes, you have to come to my class. So I went to Peter's class. And I sat in the very, very back row. As a matter of fact, I made a back row of my own. He talked for an hour and a half about essential oils. And he passed them around the room. He opened them and passed them around the room. But I never touched them. As a matter of fact, I held my hand out toward the person in the back row, so they never even passed them toward me. I would say the closest I got to any essential oil was about 3 feet during that time. At the end of class, I went back to where I was selling my books, and the woman in the booth next to me was a woman with one of the major herbal distributors, a woman quite used to herbs and herbal smells. And she turned to me and she said, my goodness, where have you been? You reek. What did she mean that I reeked?
You smelled of the essential oils.
Well, but I didn't touch them, Lanita.
You don't have to. All you have to do is be within a certain range of them, and that smell will get into you.
The oils are volatile, and they disperse into the air, and they were on my skin, my clothing, my hair, and I had also inhaled them, and they were in my lungs and bloodstream, weren't they?
Yep.
Even though I hadn't touched them. Yep. Now, I went to Peter the next day, and I said, Peter, I'm going to be talking about your class for a very long time. And I want to be sure that I have really heard you correctly and truly, so that what I say about your class is what you said. I do not want to misrepresent you. Toward that end, would you be willing to look at my class notes? And, you know, he got that kind of pale. Oh, my goodness, what is this woman asking me to do? So I showed him my class notes, which were on a sheet of paper about 3 inches by 2 inches. And he laughed and he said, that's your notes? I said, yes. He said, well, I'm happy to go over those for you. And in the middle of that piece of paper, in big letters, I had extract, concentrate, purify. That evening, he gave the notes back to me. He said, you got it all absolutely perfect. I would have added da-da-da-da-da. I would have added da-da-da-da-da, but you got it right. And I pointed to those three words in the center of the paper, and I said, Peter, did I get this right? You make an essential oil by first extracting something from the plant, then by concentrating it, and then by purifying it. He said, you got it right. That's how you make an essential oil. So let me ask you this, Lanita. If I went to a plant and I extracted from that plant an alkaloid, and then I concentrated and purified that alkaloid and sold that alkaloid under the brand name aspirin, would it be an herbal medicine?
Yeah.
Really? You would consider aspirin an herbal medicine?
No.
No, it's not an herbal medicine because those three actions is what creates a drug. There are tens of thousands of drugs made by applying those three actions to plants. Extract, concentrate, purify. Essential oils are drugs. They are not plants. They are not herbal medicine. They are drugs. They are strongly concentrated. Have you ever spilled an essential oil on anything, Lanita?
Thankfully, no. I don't use them myself, but I have seen I've seen people that do, and it just doesn't go away.
So if you spill it on a finished table, it will remove the finish from the table.
Yeah.
If you pour an essential oil into a plastic bottle, it will melt the plastic, not right away, but it will eventually just disintegrate the plastic. So remember earlier in the show, we were talking about the cell walls of plants, and that wood is an example of cell walls, and that you couldn't run a truck over me because I don't have cell walls. What I have is cell membranes, and my cell membranes are made of fat.
Yep.
My cell membranes are a lipid layer, a double lipid layer, and essential oils melt the cell membranes within my body and destroy mitochondria, the energy-producing part of my cells.
Yep.
So, again, I don't have to ingest that essential oil. Being in a room with it is enough to bring it into my bloodstream and to start minor damage. Now, obviously, our bodies are very, very good at repairing damage, right? I'm not saying that essential oils are the only thing that damage us. Certainly, smoking tobacco damages us. Breathing smog damages us. Being exposed to radioactivity damages us. But most of us don't go out and pay good money to damage ourselves.
Exactly. And think that we're doing good things for ourselves.
What Peter teaches about the essential oils, that they're antibacterial, that they're antimicrobial, that they're antifungal. And I believe, and there is a huge body of evidence now to support me in this, I've been telling people for over 30 years, health starts in your gut. Health starts with what we now call the microbiome.
Mm-hmm.
And that microbiome is made up of microorganisms, molds, yeast, bacteria, and fungi, all of which essential oils kill.
Yep.
So using essential oils, again, we do not have to ingest them. Using them in toothpaste, using them in shampoo, using them in body creams, burning them, using them in any way at all, disables your gut flora and makes you overall less healthy. Now, if somebody says to me, well, essential oils are better than antibiotics, maybe, but they're both drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And truthfully, I would prefer to use an antibiotic than an essential oil in most instances. In fact, in most instances, when I'm dealing with a bacterial infection, I would use herbs such as yarrow tincture. And yarrow tincture is what I use to brush my teeth because I don't want to brush my teeth with toothpaste that contains essential oil, or rinse my mouth with a mouthwash that contains essential oil.
Yeah.
So I'll tell you how I got onto this. It was really kind of funny, Lalina.
Mm-hmm.
1 year, I had three different women come to me with the same problem. And their problem was that their immune systems weren't functioning. Or if they were functioning, they were functioning in really weird and cranky ways.
Uh-huh.
And so I said to myself, because life always brings us things that we can like kind of find something in. I said to myself, what is the same about these three women? I don't do like a clinic, so they weren't in my community. I deal with students all over the world. And what finally occurred to me was that all three of them were massage therapists.
Oh.
They were all up to their elbows
in essential oils
for hours every day. And when I got them to stop using essential oils, their immune systems came back really strong.
Wow.
One of them, a wonderful woman named Mary Rose, went on to create something called natural scent therapy. Let's say that you want to get a massage with the scent of lavender in the air.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than using lavender essential oil. And the smallest figure that I've been given for the amount of lavender plants in a 1 ounce bottle of lavender oil is 1,000 pounds of lavender.
That in and of itself is just despicable to me, because you think of all the plants that are wasted and dead
making that
because
oil,
of this,
exactly.
To make this oil. They're all destroyed.
What she suggests is that you buy one lavender plant, put it in the room where you're going to do the massage, rub it with your hands, and the room will be scented with lavender for the whole massage.
Yep.
And you can actually keep on using that lavender plant over and over again, day after day, week after week, year after year. What she does is she has several aromatic plants, rosemary, lavender, thyme, lemon balm, rose geranium, and she has a little scented garden in pots. And then the one she wants for the massage, she brings in.
That's awesome.
Brushes to make that scent in the room.
Yep.
And so she never has to buy anything. She has freed herself from the chain of being a consumer.
And that's a tough chain to break, too.
It is indeed.
It really is in the society.
Using natural scent therapy. Mm-hmm. Of course we love scent. I'm not against scent.
No.
I'll tell you another funny story. Odd things happen to me. And it's because I travel around a lot. I'm at another conference. This is the Green Nations conference.
Uh-huh.
And they're up on stage introducing all the teachers. Well, I've already been introduced and I'm off the stage. And somebody comes up. She has some health problem. And I don't want to interrupt the introduction. So we kind of duck out and I talk to her about her problem. And as we're ducking out, they're introducing the father of aromatherapy. And I deal with her problem and I pass the day, I teach whatever. And then that evening I'm sitting eating dinner and here's this man who comes and sits down next to me and I look at him and I say, are you the father of aromatherapy? He says, yes. I said, I don't think you want to eat dinner with me. And he said, oh, I want to eat dinner with you. I have sought you out to eat dinner with you.
Really?
And I said, really? Why is that? He said, you appear to be the only sane person left in America. I said, did I get this wrong? I thought you were the father of aromatherapy. He says, aromatherapy consists of one drop of essential oil on a cotton ball put in the farthest corner of the room away from the treatment area. That ball then put in a plastic bag and reused as many times as possible. I cannot believe you people are burning essential oils into the air. I cannot believe you are putting them directly on the skin, even diluted.
Wow.
So I personally don't use essential oils. I avoid any soaps, any creams, any products that contain essential oils. And that can be difficult. But mm-hmm. more and more people are understanding the problems with essential oils. And they're far-reaching problems, aren't they? They're individual problems and they're global problems.
Yeah.
They're consumer problems and they're ecological problems.
Mm-hmm. Because of all the waste.
Because of how many plants are used to make these essential oils. Just another kind of maybe horrifying essential oil story. My daughter was in the area of the Twin Towers on the day before they were hit by the plane. So she was there 9:10.
Mm-hmm.
And she bought a turtle, a tiny quarter-sized turtle from a vendor there that day. And she has kept that turtle all of these years. This turtle is bigger than a dinner plate now. She goes to Costa Rica with her family in the wintertime, and she cannot take the turtle with her. The turtle is called Big Mama.
Mm-hmm.
She can't take Big Mama with her. So she gave Big Mama to someone to care for the wintertime. And she's now back. And the person who was caring for Big Mama said, you know, there seems to be some like junky stuff growing on Big Mama's shell. And Justine said, here's some tea tree oil. Instructions are on there. And the instructions were to put one drop in a gallon of water and gently bathe the area.
Right.
And this person poured the tea tree oil on the shell and scrubbed it in with a toothbrush.
Oh. No.
The entire piece of shell died and fell off.
What? Oh, my goodness. I you know, if people haven't listened so far to what she's been saying about this, I think listening to the fact that it destroyed and killed the shell of this tortoise ought to tell you these oils are not natural and they're not good for you.
I will also make a small risk here. And I again, absolve this studio or this radio station from any involvement what I'm about to say. But as far as I am concerned, multi-level marketing is not something we ever want to be involved in. And if you got essential oils multi-level marketed, run the other way as fast as you can. These people who are multi-level marketing essential oils are out there telling women to put essential oils directly on their nipples before they nurse their babies.
Oh, what? Wow.
I'm not going to mention their name because I don't want to give them that publicity.
Yeah, no.
But you will know who they are. It will be pretty obvious they are pushing essential oils. Think about it. What they are saying are half-truths.
No.
And I'm not saying that what they're saying is complete lies. Essential oils mm-hmm. can be used in the way they say, but so can antibiotics.
Right.
And I don't think anybody would tell a woman to put antibiotic on her nipple
no.
nursing her baby.
The damage that they do to your cellular structure can be repaired over time by stopping the use of these oils, right?
Absolutely.
Okay.
We make something like 7 trillion cells every second. I mean, we repair ourselves pretty darn fast. We get a brand new liver every 30 days, brand new kidneys every 40 days. The entire lining of the gut is replaced every 24 hours. We're hard at work.
Yeah. Well, we have 2 minutes left, so I want to thank you for being with us tonight, Susan. We have discussed many, many things, and I know there are so many things we could have gone over, and maybe, you know, we'll have you back in the future, because I know there are still more things that we have to talk about that we run out of time.
I am so honored that you have given me this time. Thank you, Lenita. And I want to leave everyone thinking about this. Herbal medicine is people's medicine. It's the medicine that grows right outside your door.
Yeah, it definitely is. And now, your websites, once again, for those who would like to look into, you have workshops and correspondence courses, right?
Correspondence courses, and you do your correspondence course at your own pace. You never have to stop being a correspondence course student. Come to SusanWeed.com, S-U-S-U-N, Susan Weed, or we got the wrong spelling to Suzanne Weed. And you can
that was
find
smart.
You can find me at Wise Woman Bookshop, and there you'll find my schedule. I'm all over the place. I'm going to be in Australia, California, Arizona, Toronto, Kansas, lots of places yet this year. You'll find my correspondence courses and all 5 of my books, including my newest book, Down There, Everything Below the Belt for Men and Women.
Oh, wow. Awesome. So that's your newest book. And can they get that on Amazon, or is that just through the website?
Oh, certainly you can get it on that. The bookseller named for a big, strong woman.
Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Yeah. Amazon. It certainly is, isn't it? I've actually never thought of it that way, but that's actually what it is. That's amazing.
Amazon bookstore was one of the preeminent women's bookstores in the United States for many decades. And then this other company took their name. They sued, but they didn't have the high-priced lawyers, and they lost, mm-hmm. and they were not allowed to call themselves by a name they had used for more than 25 years.
Wow. Now, do you have a Facebook page?
Oh, yes, and wonderful posts. My past apprentice, Rebecca, does fabulous Facebook posts.
Awesome.
So come to Susan Weed and enjoy the Facebook posts we just posted about elderflower champagne, if you're living where the elderflower is blooming.
Okay, excellent. Also, you guys, you can find Anomalous Realities on Facebook. It's facebook.com/anomalousrealities. You can also visit my shaman page, which is facebook.com/shamanelder. And also, you can follow on Twitter. Do you have a Twitter? My Twitter is @NitaWho. Do you have a Twitter, Susan?
No, I don't think that
okay.
I have a Twitter.
Okay. All right. And that is it for this evening. I want to thank everybody for listening and tuning in. And thank you, Mark, for being with us tonight. I know it was a little bit awkward for you.
No, it's fine. That was very interesting stuff.
Yeah.
I enjoyed all the topics. Mushy broccoli through to dynamic equilibrium.
Definitely so. All right. Have a wonderful evening and a wonderful weekend, everyone. And thank you for listening. Good night.
Good night.